Welcome guys, it's Glenn from Launch. Today's video I'm going to cover on a product which is the PADVII. This video is actually a training video for new users of PADVII to cover a lot of the features that PADVII has. And I'm going to explain what the requirements are and what the functionality is regarding them. Now, with this video, if you're a current user of a PADVII, you probably know a lot of the functions anyway, but there may be something that you might pick up. Now, I might break up this video into a different number of videos because there's so much to cover. So what I'll do is we'll start at the beginning of when you receive the PADVII in the kit. Now, I've done previous videos of unboxing and going through bits and pieces, but I thought I'd do this current video for the current software version that the PADVII has, which is still current. And this PADVII, which is the largest one of all the launch scan tools, which is a 13-inch screen and also runs the SmartLink VCI. Now, the SmartLink VCI, if you're not aware of it, it actually does see light vehicles, which is the passenger vehicles, and commercial vehicles in one if you've got the software. So you can purchase the passenger vehicles and then you can upgrade and buy a package for the commercial vehicles, which is their heavy duty, and load it and use the same VCI. Now, the very first thing is, as what I want to explain is at the beginning, when you do receive your unit, the actual software probably needs the upgrading. Now, this is not only just the system software, but it could be the vehicle software and so forth. Now, the very first thing is between the manufacturer to dealer and dealer to the end user, we may be a day or so in between from dealer to the end user, which is the workshops. There might be software needs to be updated. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you what you need to do when you do receive your unit. Now, in the setup I've got here, you can see I've got the background, which is actually a PADVII. The PADVII has a number of ports, which is a HDMI and a USB-C and a USB-A port. In this presentation and that, I've actually hooked up a mouse to the USB-A, so I can actually interface with the PADVII, and the HDMI is monitored to this screen so I can record it. But you can actually use it to a monitor to enlarge the screen size if you're in a workshop for some reason. Now, the very first thing what you need to do, you need to make sure that the internet is hooked up to. There's a number of ways of doing this. Is one, you can click onto the gear on the tablet itself because it's an Android operating system and go to the network internet. Or what I recommend you just do is just go to the launch APK, which is the application, fire it up and come down to other modules, which we'll cover in these next videos, and go to tablet settings. And then you end up in the same area, which is the network and internet. And you just click on your Wi-Fi and select your Wi-Fi and username and password. Now, also one of the problems what covers, which I'll do in these videos, is certain areas you've got issues with your PADVII communicating to the vehicle or communicating to the VCI or to the internet, what to check. And I'll cover these while we go through the video itself. And just make sure a number of them accidentally hit the airplane mode. And once the airplane mode, you lose the Wi-Fi communications between all of them. So just make sure that the Wi-Fi, the airplane mode is off when you're doing that. So once you've established your internet communications and you're on internet, the next section is go back and go to the wireless upgrade. Now, once you hit the wireless upgrade, this upgrades the system. So click this, it will actually check to see if you've got the current version and then download it. Make sure you've got a good battery to the tablet while it's doing this process. And that's the next step you would do. From there, you should be able to then just manually go back to the main interface, and this is what we'll cover. Now, I'll explain to you the top menu itself, and then we'll work into the interface itself. Now, the X431 Pad 7 and the V7.00029 is the version of the application or of the interface itself, and it can be updated on every so often. New functions, new features, and it might increase, and the number will increase in size, but this will be in the download area. The other one is you click on the person area here, it will go to the user information. This is about the user itself, and we'll cover that later on. The next one is the help area. Now, the help area is the technical support area that you can actually click on and send a message directly to headquarters where a technician would answer it, and you can see if they're online in their working hours, and you can talk to them directly from there. So it's a help area directly for you. We'll cover the interface itself, and I'll go through each one, and we'll just explain to you each one, and I might, as I said, we'll break down, but the first ones I'll cover in this video. So the intelligent diagnosis, it actually checks the VCE is connected, it reads the VIN of the vehicle, and then decodes it, and then it enters into the software itself. Now, with some cases, if you find that it doesn't talk to this first bit, it means that the connection to the VCI is not made. Or the VIN number is not read, means that the vehicle is not turned on, or it cannot read the VIN. Some vehicles you cannot read the VIN because it's not stored in the area that the search is done. Now, in some cases also, once the VIN is actually read, deciphering the VIN is normally done by manufacturer and then the year model. And the database sometimes doesn't, for those different countries, might vary in its database. So it might pick up two GM vehicles, one Holden, one GM, for instance. Or Ford might be a Fairstar, which is not correct in this case, because it's looking for a different type of model, but the year model is exactly right. Now, once you're on the internet, you can actually, if it doesn't do that, you can actually do a manual search, and I'll show you how to do that later on. Now, once you go back into a manual search, it's very similar to the VIN search in local diagnostics. You can actually enter it by manually, which is this one here, and you would enter the VIN number here. But if you previously worked on the vehicle and entered it the first time, if you hit the arrow button, it will actually drop down the previous VINs that you've been in, you just select it. So every time you enter a VIN number in here and go into that vehicle, the next time you can actually use this area here, which stores the VINs for you. And then you select the VIN and it's just quicker for you. You don't have to reread it. So that's a manual way of doing the VIN number itself, and if you worked on the vehicle previously. So we'll go back. Now, once we go, as I said, the intelligent diagnosis, we go into that, it reads the VIN, it'll decode it. Now, I want to explain to this next bit. We need to be on the internet to make sure intelligent diagnosis works properly. The local diagnostics, you just go in, it'll enter the vehicle and enter that way. Okay, you turn the ignition on. It scans to the vehicle. And this time will vary on the vehicle itself and the amount of information. So I'll just give you an example. And then you got topology straight away. The next part is, once I go out, is the scan history of the vehicle. You must be on the internet to receive this. So for instance, it'll give you it's the actual log is actually time date stamped, And to get into this vehicle, I actually have to be on the internet. Otherwise, you will not receive this report. So, for instance, if I go back, and it, for some reason, the internet is turned off, which is an example, and I enter into this area, you'll get this message. So confirm that the internet is turned on, and then you'll receive the message itself. So I'll go back, make sure the internet is hooked up, and then I go back into the report to the server. So every time you save the reports, it actually goes to the server, and then this is where you retrieve it back for the history, the scan history of that vehicle itself. So we'll just go back, and that's that point of time. Quick access, the same thing. You need to be hooked up to the internet, and it'll go directly into that area because the certain information is logged on where you were on the server itself for that vehicle itself. So that's how it works. You must be on the internet itself, otherwise it won't work correctly. So I just wait for that, and then you go to topology. So we'll go back out here. We'll go back to the vehicle later. So again, with quick access, the same thing. You need to be hooked up to the internet. And it's the same way as I explained before. So we'll just enter that. And I'll enter it, exit, and go through. Now regarding the buttons along the bottom, the return button, the home button, which will go to the home. Just go back there. Okay. So once you hit home again, you'll go back to where you were. In some cases, you have to go out of the diagnostics, especially if you're doing remote diagnosis. You've got to get out of this area and then go back to the home page completely before you do remote diagnosis. The other one is multiple screens, which I'll show you how to do this. The next one is the green symbol. It's the connection to the VCI. Once you've talked to the VCI, it will go green. And this is an indication the VCI is talking to the tablet itself. The next one is a snapshot. It'll send a picture directly to the gallery, and you can print it or you send it somewhere else later on. And the other one is the button for the Explorer. It will actually go to the internet. It'll default to mycar.x431.com, and then you can explore, or you can do your own searches via the Google area itself once you've got an account. Okay, so once we go back, the next section is the updates themselves. Now, the updates, software updates, if you've got a current or a new version, as soon as you receive the machine, it'll be in the available area, meaning that it's here ready for you to download, and you might have to tick it to download it. Otherwise, the downloaded versions are already listed here, and the reason why they're here is, one, if I have an issue with a new version, and you can see it's this ABS bleeding is 11.04 and the current one is 0.42. For some reason I've had an issue with this version, you possibly could download an old version. So you click on the arrow, select the old version, it'll go back to 0.2, click on it, and then you can download that old version and then try it. So it depends on if you've got an issue that it worked before and I downloaded that version. And it could be because the version, because the internet interruptions or corrupted in that way when it downloaded, might not be right. So you can either re-download that version again or an older version. And now it's installing, it's a different color. You can see the speed of the download. So if you've got internet problems, you can see it from that point. And the software, the VCI number. So that's the regarding the update. So if I go back in, and now you can see the availability is there because it's a newer version to what I had. So again, I would click on here, then update it, and then it'll give me the new version. Okay, so you can see the internet speeds from here and the VCI number, and make sure that VCI is correct. It should match the one that you're using. I'll just wait for that to download. And it's done. And then it'll finish. Okay, so we can go back into that area. Now, also in the download area, if you wanted to know, you can click on this area, little arrow at the end here, and it'll actually tell you a bit of information regarding that version, if there's something special being downloaded. So you can go here and it tells you what they've done in that version software itself. So that's a good point if you want to see if something's updated regarding that version itself. Now, the information center, it's mainly to do with the tips and running of the scan tool itself. Again, you have to be on the internet to do this. And the other thing is the fix. X431 fix is loaded here. Now, with the X431, you have to have purchased the actual account and your username and password to enter this. If you haven't, you can actually preview it before you want to purchase it through the mall. So you'll just go into this area and it gives you a demonstration version on how the fix works. But with the X431 fix, in the fault code area, which I'll show you, once you hit fix, it will read the fault code, store it, and then load it into the fix area, X431 fix, as a fault code. So for instance, if I was reading this 2AG and I enter this area, and I read the fault code will actually appear here. And then you can actually look up the fault code automatically. It's interfaced with the Haynes Pro and Fix are interfaced together via the servers to give you this feature itself. And you'll see videos that I've done regarding Fix previously. So you just go back to my video and you'll see regarding Fix itself. So that's regarding the information. So you can have a brief look at that and before you purchase the software itself, or the description of the Haynes Pro workshop data. So I'll go back. And again, you have to be on the internet with this. So just going back now, I can exit out of it. We'll go back into here. Now, the diagnostic history. Again, this is where you, every time we go into the actual vehicle itself, we record where you've been regarding a report or something to do with that. So you can click on that history and it'll give you the report that's been saved previously. You can print it, share it, or quick access directly to the vehicle if you're doing this. But the access will be to this module that you've been doing the report in. So if I hit quick access, like I mentioned before, in the history area or the diagnostics, it'll enter the vehicle this way. So you need to be prepared. It won't go into all the modules. You'll see the difference here. So I'll just load this up for you. And it loads up. And you can see that I've only been into these three modules to do the report. But if I go through the diagnosis, the topology will be larger. So this is just to do with that report. These are the modules I entered into it. That's why it changes. So exit, exit, and that explains the history. So the next ones I'll cover is the TPMS in the next video.